Good afternoon from the Leicester Tigers Stadium, and welcome to a historic day in recent England history, because the A-team make their return to the international fold for the first time in 8 years, and they welcome Portugal to the East Midlands. Well, 15,000 tickets have been sold in advance for this fixture that has truly captured the imagination of the English rugby public. Great excitement followed the team announcement earlier in the week, with all 23 labelled as prospects for future England reckoning. Young men bursting with talent, with all 10 Premiership sides represented in the match day 23 today. They've had a great week, so I hear. The focus on bonding, the focus on cohesion, the focus on one purpose. And they welcome a side who may not have returned from France's World Cup with the William Webb Ellis, but they certainly captured the hearts of the rugby public. An exhilarating brand of rugby the Portuguese played with, and they are looking to emulate that here today for the first time against England A since 2009. Well, a man who's played for England A and played countless times in the Premiership, Christian Day, is alongside me for this one.
Yeah, it's a great day to be here as well. What a, you know, got to remind myself it's February. What a day to play rugby. It's cool, but it's dry. And we're at one of the best grounds in the country in terms of like a real rugby ground, a real atmosphere. And they've turned out in big numbers to be here.
Well, there's no shortage of interest for this match, is there? It's an A-team in name, but really fervently supported, and there's walk-ups as well, and the draw as well is Portugal, who are coming. That brand that I spoke of that was really incredible throughout the World Cup, they were the team that everyone was talking about.
Yeah, I think talking about England first, you mentioned, you know, Steve Borthwick was quite pointed in his press conference during the week when they announced the A-team, and he's clearly had a strong steer on who's been picked, and he said that he expects these players to go to that senior shirt in the near future. So it's exciting for those players. Massive opportunity today. In terms of Portugal, you know, it's a team that's changed from that World Cup team. I think we've got to front up to that. They're in the middle of their European Championships. We're missing some of the big names that we saw at the World Cup. But for them, what a challenge today. Some of these young Portuguese players get to play at one of the most historic grounds in England. Big crowd against some of the biggest up-and-coming stars that England have to offer. So for them, a real challenge. They have to play the game differently to England. And lastly, brilliant to see so many people here supporting the boys.
Well, plenty more to come from Christian and I, but let's hear it from the coaches.
George, massive day game today. England A back in action. How good has this week been, getting the boys together, kind of a new coaching group, new player setup? How has it been for you?
It's been awesome. I think different challenges to a usual Premiership week. Lots of different staff from different clubs to start with, so try and get aligned quickly in the background, and then all the players pour in from different clubs coming down from Steve's camp, and we've got to get aligned quickly. But we've kept it simple. We've done what we can in, you know, three training sessions realistically, but boys have been brilliant. They've applied themselves. Staff have been outstanding, you know, trying to mop up the different bits from different camps. But it's been really enjoyable. Obviously now we just want to perform on the pitch.
In terms of what you've kind of done bonding wise, messages on the pitch, kind of how difficult has that been, knowing you've had such a short space of time together?
Yeah, it's a challenge, you know, like it's these guys are trying to knock seven bells out of each other week to week, and then you come together and you're straight into it, you know, with sort of a week before you play a game. So definitely challenges. We hit the bonding bit early on and tried to get everybody out of their comfort zones, and hopefully we did that. As the week gathered momentum, the boys, you know, definitely came out their shells. You see more and more characters coming through, and some great leadership from Charlie, Harry and Joe, those boys coming down from the camp, Max as well. So yeah, as the week's gone, we feel confident, we feel good. It's not going to be perfect, we know that, but how we respond to that's important.
Portuguese rugby in general seems on the rise, particularly after the World Cup. What are you expecting from the side you're facing today?
Yeah, look, they had a really, really good World Cup. I think they play, you know, we recognise in transition they are very, very dangerous, and scored an outstanding try last weekend that would definitely be up there in the top five of the year so far. But yeah, look, massive threat there, but they've got a good all-round game. I think they challenged in the World Cup, they challenged across the board, and you know, probably the danger for us today is we've set out with a game plan, and if Portugal do get into their flow and it becomes you know, hectic and chaotic. The challenge for us is to take control of that and play the way we want to play. And we do want to have a crack, but, you know, you don't want to get sucked into a world of playing sevens rugby, and, you know, that's really going to suit Portugal.
In terms of the actual venue today, Welford Road, good crowd expected today, kind of a proper real heartland of rugby as well. A real great venue, I guess, for England A to return at.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a great venue. You know, it's outstanding. You know, the bits we were talking about this, me and Sam, because obviously we've both got experience of playing here, and the stadium seems to have built year on year, and every time you come, there's another piece to it. But it's, you know, it's a proper cauldron. We all know that from coming here, and hopefully we'll have that on our side today, and it's very, very exciting.
George, thank you for your time. Best of luck today.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Gonzalo, welcome to Leicester, welcome to England. How much are you looking forward to playing this England A team today?
Very much. We are looking forward to this game. We prepared the team during the week, piece by piece, receiving some guys from the first team. A lot of players to develop, young players, and this will be a very good challenge for us. Good level of competition, so we're looking forward to play.
How much do you feel like Portuguese rugby is on the rise after the World Cup in particular? A lot of rugby nations kind of focus on Portugal. It seems to really be on the up at the moment.
Yeah, so we've been working for the last 4 years in the preparation for the World Cup and everything around it. Like you guys saw, we like to play like a positive rugby, and that's why I think people look at us. And that's what we want to play rugby, to risk and to compete with every team that we play.
Is that what you want to do today, to play rugby, yeah. Throw the ball around, look to take advantage?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly that. We already saw some weak points of England, the first team, well. And I think we have some advantages that we can explore.
In terms of playing at a place like Leicester, very famous rugby stadium, playing an England A side that's got many internationals in it, what are you expecting from the whole afternoon today?
Well, first of all, I expect a really good environment here, packed, right, the stadium. So we're not used to play like this in Portugal, so it's going to be an extra motivation for the players. And I'm sure that it will be very good for us. Good pressure. Yeah.
Thank you very much for your time. Good luck today. Thank you.
Well, in a rather neat piece of rugby symmetry, George Skivington and Gonçalo Faro last met when England A played Portugal back in the day at Edgeley Park. And that is the man whose brainchild this rebooting of England A is. Conor O'Shea, Executive Director of Performance for England Rugby. He's got big ambitions for this programme, Christian.
Yeah, we know it's something that historically has existed. He's been very successful. That Saxons team went to the Churchill Cup and things like that. And, you know, Conor said he wants it back. Doesn't know quite what it's going to look like yet, but these kind of fixtures are the future.
And here strides the future of Portuguese rugby. There'll be many names that you became familiar with out in France that aren't present today. But there is a thriving under-20 programme that is being given senior oxygen today here at Welford Road. Whilst for England, renamed, rebooted, reinvigorated, the A-team are here, and England keen to make this side the Hillary step before the Everest that is full England recognition.
I said pre-game, players want opportunities. These are all professional players. They all want the opportunity to prove themselves, to develop. And ultimately, like you say, the Everest has pulled on the England shirt at Twickenham. So the opportunity is there for all these boys today. I hope they take it. I hope they play a good, bad brand of rugby. And I hope Portugal give them a good game.
For some of these individuals in white and red, the first time pulling on their national jersey, and a proud, proud moment to bellow out their anthems. For the first time since South Africa in 2016, 15 men start in the England A jersey. They say good things come in threes. Well, there's two trios as tasty as the other out there. Josh Hodge, Caden Murley and Will Muir tries oozing from that back three, whilst the back row of Pearson, Pepper and Barbary offers the 360 nature of Pearson, the electric jackal work of Pepper and the pure destruction of Barbary's carrying. So much to look forward to from the run outside. Amongst the replacements, well, take your pick. A replacement front row to match any. And great excitement for Ollie Hartley as well, who's been in such rude health for Saracens all season. For Portugal, well, they're going to be looking to their speeds as their youngsters, the likes of Alfredo Almeida, José Gomes and José Maria Cortes, to match that England back three. And Vasco Leite is one to watch in the centres. Nicola Fernandez offers the beef, and Francisco Almeida and José Roque are going to look to be a match to that England back row. Abel de Cunha and Kevin Baptista and Boaventura Almeida offer international experience amongst a bench that is otherwise packed with debutants. Well, a young man who knows these blades of grass rather well from a season and a bit here at Welford Road. He calls King's home home now, but a great prospect and great expectation upon him and Christian as well, Manu Vareiro.
Yeah, Atkinson Vareiro is a good matchup. Vareiro, young boy, starts for the Portuguese champs. Hell of a player. Let's see where he goes on today.
Well, it's an all-French officiating affair led by Luc Ramos from Béziers. Charlie Atkinson has the honour of reigniting the dormant England A by kicking into the arms of José Gomes. He found himself in the International Sevens jersey in Cape Town at the Rugby World Cup rather recently. And Manuel Vareiro tastes a slightly late shoulder as he finds a healthy clearance.
Yeah, what a good start. What a good start for Portugal. You know, the nerves are going to be high. Big crowd today for them, but really composed from the kickoff and a really nice exit.
Jamie Blamire goes to the captain, Charlie Yules. He's been with the first team, but chosen to lead this young England side. And, well, youth courses through every pair of hands. Oscar Beard with a carry, and then Josh Hodge into the fray. An extraordinary comeback from a dislocated elbow, and Alfie Barbary set upon by three red jerseys. Ajomo, Beard misses out. Muir and Guy Pepper gets an opportunity to scamper in the 5 metre channel. And Harry Randall is never a man to hang around and licensed to tap and to go and deploy the cannonball. Barbary. England looking fluid. But a break in play and a return to a penalty for Portugal, not back 10.
Yeah, great start and great intent from that England team. I love Harry Randall. Let's get on with the game. Let's play quick. I actually think the initial penalty was quite harsh. I thought they might have won the turnover here, Portugal. He's straight on the ball. Referee gave no clear release. That's why there's a penalty there. And then, like you say, Randall forced that penalty, not back 10. But the pace that England played with there, brilliant to see. Let's see if they can keep it up.
Well, Atkinson had a pretty thorough practice yesterday alongside Jamie Shilcock here at the captain's run. Was a great deal of rugby played at the captain's run, I'll tell you. More cricket and tennis, and just a continuation of that bonding and that line-out umbilical cord between Blamire and Yules. Looking pretty fruitious at the moment as the white massive bodies drive to the paint, and England unstoppable and scoring early. And it's Jamie Blamire.
Yeah, good start, good composure from that England pack. We know there's a big size differential today. You can see it. You can see it with your eyes. When you look at the stats, it becomes quite a gaping gap. But really good from the England team there at the line out. Solid ball on Charlie Yules. He's bringing a lot of experience today. Jamie Lebrumai just sat in the chariot, really nice. Let the boys in front of him do the work. He gets the 5 points for England Day.
Well, he's no stranger to life in the armchair, is he, Jamie Lebrumai? 4 tries in 9 starts this season for the Falcons, and so often the man to emerge from a mass of bodies after a driving maul. Sweetly struck from Charlie Atkinson, but just pushed to the left of the upright, but a fine start from England.
Yeah, Jamie Lebrumai is a man who brings a lot of power to that 2 jersey. You know, lost his place in that starting England team, but he's still a man who can score tries, like you say, knows his way to the try line.
Well, Yules has spent the majority of his time airborne in these opening few minutes, and he's hoisted high again. Lucy Tuima, a second row of very different makeup.
And this is where today, you know, this is what Steve Borthwick probably wants to see. Yes, we're going to see tries and exciting rugby. He still wants to see the nuts and bolts done well.
Great chase from Will Muir, who wraps up Alfredo Almeida, who's one of these who's impressed for the under-20s, but it's a big step up today, something that Gonçalo Forlo is all too aware, and Portugal penalised again.
Yeah, so look, pretty much perfect of how you want to exit here. There's a box kick on the money, a wing who's eager to chase in Will Muir. He makes a good chop tackle, which is the tackle we want to see in the modern game. And then Tom Pearson goes straight on the ball. So clean, gave the referee no opportunity to penalise him, hands straight on the ball, wins the turnover for this England A team. You see Pearson there, number 6, he's on his feet, supporting his weight. He actually made the turnover before that. Penalty comes from the last second of 14, slapping the ball.
Well, Pearson, for much of his professional career, with the 7 on his back, so there are those jackling instincts on both sides of Alfie Barbary with Pepper and Pearson. The lineup going awry, but Atkinson first to the bounce of the ball. Randall driving the tempo. And England hurtling into the red wall. Lucy Tuima takes 2 to stop him, and Randall fancies going left. Atkinson picks a long fizzing ball to Tom Pearson, who careers over into the corner. England running red hot early here at Leicester Tigers Stadium.
Man, Pearson started well. 9 and 10 have started well for England. That's a hell of a seed. 15, 20 metre pass. Hits the big man in the wide channel. It's just so difficult to stop. He's such a big man. Dimensions of him are insane. And he's just too powerful, that close. Gets the 5 points in the corner.
He got his full England debut against Wales on the eve of the World Cup. He had hopes of France, and well, he's been outstanding since joining Saints from London Irish, where he was Player of the Season last year. He bypassed the Young Player of the Season award, just went straight to the top and said, I'll be the top dog.
He's that classic 6, isn't he? Lovely balance, the back row today.
Atkinson from slightly wider out of his first attempt. Produces a slightly closer result, but still one that doesn't yield the extra, so England have to settle for 10.
I said Tom Pearson's a classic 6. Plays a lot of time at 7, and actually, today has kind of forced him into that 6 role with Guy Pepper next to him. He's definite player of the future.
He spent his formative years playing in the second row at Cardiff Met University, which is pretty nice little production line that England have got going. The likes of Alex Dombrandt and Luke Northmore as well, who's been in England camps previously.
And there's that pragmatism, you know. England could probably run from there, they probably look to go wide, but they are going to play to a structure today, and as much as that's not quite as exciting as the 90-metre tries, I think it's important definitely to start the game, you know, start the game well.
And Pedro, the ascent on his third cap here today. Excellent prospect at hooker. Well, that's busy work from the smallest man on the pitch, Duarte Cardoso. Tigerish counter-rucking from Joe Hayes at his home club on his home pitch. And Cardoso gives it to Antonio Primens. Already Portugal seeking the extremities of the pitch but finding a lot of resistance out there. Vasco Leite, slippery customer when he wriggles free, but Portugal are in reverse. But now they've found some room in the 15-metre channel and chance to open England up, which they do. The offloading play just in their DNA. But Josh Hodge is the one to pounce.
Good contest here. Back to the knock-on.
And a bit of appreciation from this, this Welford Road crowd. It's exciting rugby, isn't it? There was a moment where you're like, where are they going here? But they get the ball to the width here. It's really nice. They were practicing the warm-up, this offload. Bring it into the game. It's brilliant play. But he stuck it on his toe maybe right at the end there. But it's a nice sign of things to come.
Passion and stability.
One, two. First scrum of the day, and this is, you know, this England pack have got about a 70 kilo Coach. Advantage here. So Portugal have got to take this blow, knuckle down.
This guy,
the captain,
keeps the space, quick reset.
Andre
keeps the space, no bringing.
And let's Antonio Prim bookending Pedro Vicente for England. Joe Hayes, Finn Baxter, and the try scorer Blamire. Baxter,
Crouch.
Only just turned 22, and he's nearly got 50 first-team appearances for Quins. He's known for his scrummaging prowess, despite his youth. But we won't get to see it in action quite yet.
And given the advantage, the weight advantage that England have, that's frustrating. That's a coach killer that they look at. If I was Portugal, I'd get the ball back in.
Scrum.
Well, they're bringing some confidence for their front five, fair play.
But, don't put pressure on your opponent.
I don't know, my sense of this is the more the ball's in play, the more it's going to benefit Portugal's style of play today. I don't think they want too many set-piece battles against what looks like a very tasty England 8 on paper.
It's a big opportunity for Duarte Cardoso today, the retirement of the great Samuel Marks. Camacho unselected, maybe with one eye on their Iberian derby with Spain in the Rugby Europe Championship at the weekend, but England move through the gears at terrifying pace.
Yeah, I think you know, ball in play is going to be beneficial to Portugal again, not engaging in scrum battles. There's a clear size power advantage there for England, and let's hope they learn that lesson pretty quick.
He's raced down from Scotland, the main man who picked this 23. It has been George Skivington's training week. He's in charge today on the match day, but it was pretty clear that Steve Borthwick selected the 23. He said who he wanted in the jerseys. And Yules is peerless in the skies at the moment. Ajomo goes out the back, opening up for Atkinson, who thinks about gliding through, but the door gets slammed shut. Will Muir, first touch of the ball for the Bath man. Barbary shows his sleight of hand. Ajomo puts a bit of fizz on it. And Pearson shows a bit of footwork, shows a bit of power, links up with Murley. Last ditch defence. And England denied.
Fantastic period of play that. Harry Randall, very, very prominent from the line out. He actually used Randall at 10. He distributed. Quick ball coming back the other way. That man Pearson again. Caden Murley couldn't quite get in the corner. Great last-ditch tackle from the Portuguese wing. But England, when they get pace on the ball, power on the ball, they look very slick, don't they, for a team that have only trained for 1 week.
To go to stability before the ball.
The second clinch of the game for the two respective packs. Alarm bells will still be ringing in the ears of the Portuguese eight after demonstration of power from England. And again, hydraulic in nature and producing a penalty.
Down under pressure.
There's a definite physical mismatch. So how do you work through that as the Portuguese team? You know, I mentioned earlier taking it low. You need a ball feed from the nine to the hooker's foot. The ball needs to be at the eight's foot as quickly as possible. Otherwise, it's going to be a very long afternoon for the men in red.
Straight into the corner, and you think straight into Jules's hands. And straight into fast forward to the line, and England have a third. Barbary, the man at the bottom of the pile of white jerseys on this occasion. And England's power game, irresistible right now.
Yeah, and I think this power game is going to be relentless. They use a plus one line out, so Barbary's hitting straight on the ball. This is a George Skivington thing. They bring great, great speed onto the mall immediately. Barbary, let's see if he gets there clean. Yes, I think he does. The Portuguese players did ask if there was a little knock on there. I think he does get the ball there, but let's see if the French referee is going to take a look.
Our TMO today is Cyril Lafont. Seemingly content. And that was grounded. And Atkinson. On the other side. Again, keeps Alfred Road in suspense. And keeps Alfred Road waiting for a conversion.
That man Barbary, he's got a new hairstyle, I like that, with the frosted tips, straight from the 90s. Does he get there clean? Let's look, places the ball. Tell you that probably needs a second look sometimes, but he's been given. Let's get on with the game.
A first error from England and transition ball for the Portuguese, which is what they thrive upon. Francisco Nobre.
Advantage over to the knock on.
Rajado, the captain, stepping in at first receiver, and Barbary, distinctive with that lid, comes piling through. A lot of hunger at the breakdown from England at the moment.
And
a lot of strength as well in Rusi Tuima. Late, gets herded back into the heavy white traffic.
Lost.
The captain.
Tackle!
Big carry, but runs into two strong men in Oscar Beard and Guy Pepper. It opens up and Charlie Yule's lassoes around the ankles. It's a challenge that needed to be made.
Kick the ball in the ruck.
Portugal have a penalty.
Kicking the ruck.
Just got there, Charlie Yule's, didn't he? The gap opened, the crowd gasped, and he just... Lasso is the right word. Penalty given in the ruck. You can't kick the ball in the ruck. You can hook it backwards. Can't kick it. And I think it was the England loose head, Finn Baxter, I think, he just stick a toe through. Watch Yule's here. Just got those ankles. Excellent penalty.
George Skivington was at pains to say that he didn't want to get embroiled in a seven-style open game because it plays into the Portuguese hands, and the ball
fair
just
contest.
About finds its way into his hand despite Tom Pearson trying to get a sticky paw in there. Jose Larocque, one of the captain internationals out there today, has a carry, and that's Jose Gomez. Portugal looking for a bit of punch in their carries. Fernandes, one of the more sizable frames out there in red for the visitors, and that's a smart bit of play, nice vision, but Josh Hodge alert to the danger. Baxter, head down. And Muir linking up with Hodge, who's back inside. The back three combining in limited space out there. And Charlie Yules, who's really reinvigorated to be playing some rugby. First time he's wearing a rose on his chest since February 2022, and Barbary smuggles one to Finn Baxter. England with lightning quick ball out the back door from Muir to Pearson. Pearson galloping in that wide channel. Hayes thought about giving it to his fellow prop. Randall just spots a glint of light and an exquisite offload to Lucy Tuima. Randall taken out, penalty advantage. Barbary might just finish it himself.
Cynical play for me.
England denied, but only for a moment, until big Lucy Tuima uses his hulking frame and his telescopic limbs to reach across. England have a four, and Portugal are reduced to 14.
Yeah, it's that man Barreiro that I highlighted pre-game. What a good attacking threat. He's cynically taken out Harry Randall there and earns the yellow card. And it doesn't make any difference because Russ Tuima barged his way over a couple of phases later. It's been a good start to this game for England, I've got to say. They played smart rugby, intentful rugby with real speed. And Pearson's roaming the wide channels, isn't he? Oh, he just kept his toe in play there. Now we've got a change of kicker as well. Josh Hodge is taking on duties. That man Atkinson isn't feeling it. And Josh Hodge is more than able in his own right.
Josh Hodge drills it emphatically through the uprights. And he converts his Exeter teammate's effort.
Big Russ Tuima. Remember seeing him in England 20s camp, and I thought someone's dad had come with him. He is a man mountain. And what a rugby family as well. Related to Akapusa Quera, Lagi Tuima, the Red Rose, and also Joe Thokonosiga is some player. Different kind of second row for England. Brings something very different. And he's had a great year with Exeter Chiefs so far.
That's a hell of a family wrestle on Christmas Day, isn't it?
There's some families you don't mess with, aren't there? I think the Tuilagis come into that category. I think the Tuimas. Akapusi Quere, if you don't know the name, what a player he was for Gloucester Rugby. Unfortunately, one of the Portuguese team leaving the field due to injury. Andre, the second row.
Thank you.
So it heralds the arrival of Kevin Baptista, who he was close to going to the Rugby World Cup. He was in the camp. He was one of just two cut very late by Patrice Lagisque. So he is someone of promise and experience, and went on that extraordinary roller coaster with Portugal. The four-year cycle to even get to France was extraordinary. And the journey begins again today here against this England A side, and an error from England.
First mistake of the day from Harry Randall. I think started this game superbly well. He's trying to put it on that man, Will Muir. What a good chaser of kicks he is. What a good athlete he is. Ex-7s player. Said that Harry Randall's been very, very impressive so far. 20 minutes in. That's his first mistake. He gives the Portuguese a good attacking chance.
The sense finds his man again. For all the woes in the scrum, the line out thus far has got some pretty pleasing mechanics. Portugal break away, and this sense carries on into the heart of the England 22. First true examination of the England defence in their own red zone. Baptista makes contact in his opening minute. Arrajada tries to propel his man through that hole. Cardoso pulls his big man around the corner. I feel there needs to be a bit more zip about the way Portugal are going about their business. Almeida glided through the hole. Well, there's no hole between Hayes and Pearson. Two large men. And Fernandes is Portugal's largest man. He gets battered back. Baptista. Again, freeing up the hands, getting the offload round the back. Cardoso in the trailing support line. And Portugal just showing that deft handling that made them such a threat across the English Channel.
Not on the ball first.
Again, England successfully sort of arrest the momentum, and Baptista brings his body into another collision. Rock takes one high, and he does well, actually, to not lose too many metres. Almeida. Portugal leave the ball behind.
Advantage over.
And they leave it to the hands of England. And a bit more sympathy required from Will Muir there, because Josh Hodge is hitting sixth gear.
Knock on to touch.
Yeah, and that man can fly. We've seen him do that in an Exeter Chiefs shirt. We've seen him in a Newcastle shirt. That man Josh Skivins, I think he'll be happy with how the game started. Like I said, there's been moments of pragmatism, there have been moments of defensive steel being required. Good from Charlie Mules here, moves the turnover. Like you say, a bit more sympathy there, and I think that man Hodge was going 60 metres down the other end. I've got to say, the Portuguese, some nice phase play there. Good defensive set for England, who look physically very able, we know that, but they're dangerous, aren't they?
Clean ball off the top, fast ball and no-look pass and
backward.
Sophisticated shapes from Portugal, but has put them on the back foot. The voraciousness of the England defence is plain to see. A lot of talk about the blitz from the senior side yesterday. And just seeing that hunger from the A team today. Portugal.
Tackle release.
30, 35 metres back from where they started.
Taking back. Stop here! Stop!
A scudded kick into the hands of Hodge, who won't think twice about countering. Just spots a bit of room to chip into, and Murley almost pouncing. England have the advantage. Beard to Blamire.
Backward.
Baxter plays it off the floor. That's play on. It's unusual circumstances to Wima. Dummy to Muir. Here goes the horse. Galloping into the try zone, and Will Muir has a try in England A colours.
What has Russ Tuima just done? We need to see this again. The pirouette from the big man here. I mean, we know Will Muir can run him in. We've seen him do it in Bath colours. Gallop of the horse. Josh Archer's little chip. Caden Murley, I think, wins the ball back. And England shift the point of attack well. Move the ball away. No knock on there. Generous. Let's have a look, Russ. Let's see what you can do. Beautiful from the big man. And, Will Muir finishes it as we know he would. But that genuinely brilliant play from Russ Tuima there. Dummy, pirouette, one-handed offload. Brings something different in that number four shirt.
Well, he picked up the nickname Horse when he was playing England Sevens, and he said it would never stick, and now there's a corner named after him at the Rec. So, bad luck, Will Muir. That one there is here for your career.
The panic. Is there a panic at the Rec? I didn't know that. I'll look out for that one. Good play from England. See, Russ Tuima again with the pirouette. He's to keep this intensity, England. When they keep the intensity high, the pace high. Harry Randall, they look good.
Maxajomo has a carry. He's looked like a wonderful distributor thus far in that 12 role. Just signed a contract extension to 2027 with Bath only last month. That's the kind of value that they're putting on Ajomo in the centre. And Randall, who is great to see, get a good run of games this year. He's been plagued by injuries. Sticks one. Oh, stop it, Portugal. Welford Road respond with delight as the Portuguese begin to open their box of tricks. Cardoso finding his big number eight, who's driven back by Baxter. And Almeida, test Beard, he spins on his heels and captures it well. Oh, that's a big, uncompromising wrestle to the ground from Almeida.
Back, hold in front.
Atkinson may have spotted a 50-22 here, catches an end. It continues to dribble. Oh, that's as tight to the touchline as can be. Will Muir's there on the scene. Then Guy Pepper, more white jerseys arriving.
Yeah.
And Portugal are scrambling, under-resourced. But Ajomo has stolen it. Muir,
second
set
one.
Upon
offside
by Nobre.
12.
Good defensive read there from Portugal, but they are missing personnel out wide. Yeah. And England just can't quite
still
get it to the unmarked Murley. He's still screaming for the ball out wide. England turn to the phases. They turn to Tom Pearson. Atkinson misses out Hodge, delivers it to Murley, and he delivers what feels like a customary try every time he takes to the field. The Harlequin, the latest England man to get in on the act.
I'm definitely watching this game with a smile on my face. The circus tricks have come out for Portugal. Dancing feet there. Look who the next man is here. Great tackle from Muir. Who's next? No, we cut him off. Guy Pepper, 7. 60-metre sprint to make the turnover. Ball to the wick, and Caden Murley slips over the way we see him doing a Quinn shirt. He's so slippery quick.
Okay, thank you.
Changes his pace so well. Not an easy tackle to make at the best of times. Certainly not when you're 29-0 down. And England continue to impress when they play at high tempo.
Well, Hodge, the replacement kicker, sizes this up, and you don't see him off the tee too much for Exeter, but he is prodigious. He went through the entire under 26 nations, not missing a single kick. And he doesn't let me down from out wide. England now in the conversions as well as the tries, and in absolute command.
The turnover came from Guy Pepper, the ball goes to the win. That man Murley in the corner. Charlie Atkinson at 10, not a good day with the boot, but he's controlling this game well.
Ajomo to Barbary. It goes skittling through the red jerseys, then up for more. George Skivington and Charlie Yule said in the week, all he wants is the ball in his hands, and every England player wants it now. Murley hits the speed button, but the offload just feathered forward.
And if we're going to be hypercritical, and it is being hypercritical, some of these offloads, if they go to hand, you know, the Will Muir, a bit of the sympathy on his pass, England would probably have two more tries on the board because those outside backs look so fast, so dangerous.
Unless you're Roussi Touima, he can do what he wants.
Well, second row is showing the backs how to do it, exactly. It's true, though, that if you're holding yourself to the very highest standards, which we should be if you're in an England shirt, these offloads need to go to hand if we're going to finish things off from distance.
Crouch!
Well, let's not forget that Portugal have been fighting with a man disadvantage. They're back to the full complement now. And they need every single body in this scrum. But they get the penalty, which will be sweet relief for,
second time,
for the pack there.
Push.
Yeah, so early push. Early, first one would be a free kick.
Touch missed, smartly dealt with by Caden Murley, and a booming left boot from Charlie Atkinson. A cannon!
Thanks to the air, it's Cortez, the left wing, he's signalling that it's gone straight out, but he's kicked it from his own 22, so he's allowed to kick it straight out. It's just, it's, as you say, a 60-metre howitzer that's divided the pitch in two. brilliant from Burnley there. Knows the rules, jumps, catches the ball, lands in field. Secures the ball for England.
Taking back.
Atkinson had a bit more 22 to work with as well.
Taking
makes
back.
It all the more impressive.
No, outside.
Go pick! Go pick!
Inside now. No,
Portugal.
No
eager to exit and exit well. They go to Barreiro. Who this time doesn't give Murley the opportunity to deliver it back.
I'll say this in the best sense of the word, but Guy Pepper is
an
absolute pain in the backside in the defensive run. Like, he's in every tackle he makes. He's looking to be destructive, but then he's looking to disrupt the ball as well. He's a defensive machine.
Believe it or not, as we get called back and Barbary gets called back,
not in the middle.
Believe it or not, it's actually the first time that Guy Pepper is pulling on an England jersey of any description. He's been so unlucky with injuries around the age group stuff, always being looked to be called up, but he was injured, and then there was the COVID year.
On the line.
And here today, a very proud day for him, and he's still studying at Durham University. So the talent ceiling for him is pretty high. Pearson with the wraparound, and Randall is electric. Josh Hodge is no slouch either. He dances through the last-ditch defence of the Portuguese. The pick of the bunch from the England team, and Josh Hodge, the man to put the exclamation mark at the end of it.
Nice bit of set play from England. Let's have a look on the replay if we can. Four-man line out, they hit Barbary into midfield. Harry Randall on the wrap. Loads of space. Josh Hodge jogging next to him. Give me the ball. Beautiful footwork. Right foot, left foot, steps off both feet. And a Chris Ashton dive to finish. I think Harry Randall can't quite believe the space he has here. He's just completely blown the Portuguese defence with the set play. It's so difficult that, to be able to step off both feet, fend with both hands. That man Hodge is a classy operator.
Very special player, Josh Hodge, and a wonderful professional as well, I'm told. His dislocated elbow, it was, you can see, just strapped up there. Doesn't hinder him on another successful knock. It was meant to be a five-month injury, but he was back in 2.5 months. He was so dedicated with his rehab.
He looks like an athlete, doesn't he? And I believe at schoolboy level he was a heptathlete of some pedigree. He not just for the hair, reminds me of Ian Balshaw. Slick mover.
Yes, it's nine.
Harry Randall drops another very contestable, chaseable kick onto Alfredo Almeida, and Portugal are in a battle to get any sniff of the ball at the moment. Barbary is doing some pilfering, and Guy Pepper skirts inside but finds a tough left shoulder. Baxter does really well, shows great dexterity there. Speaking of dexterity, here's Big Roussy.
Play on.
Can't get his offload away this time, and Pepper grows into the game and explodes into the tackle. Dispossessed.
Offside, you're on the ground. Play the ball.
He's been good since he's come on, but Baptista. He's been destructive carrying and made a good shot on Pepper there. I'll be interested to see how the ball came out. I actually thought he ripped it in the tackle. Mr. Ramos says it was on the floor, which of course is illegal. Let's have a look. I think he got that in the tackle. It's a harsh. But that's what's been given. Let's get on with the game. He's brought a bit of physicality, hasn't he, Baptista, which this Portuguese pack need.
I don't think there's any question marks over there. Ball handling is there, and that sort of ability to get to the outside edges. It is that physicality that they're coming off second best at the moment, though.
Definitely stolen in the tackle. That was unlucky. Really unlucky for the big one.
Lemire.
Thank you. Hooker, in the middle. In the middle.
Isn't quite central.
I want to see Portugal compete here, particularly on Jules. Don't let Jules take an easy ball.
Well, instead, it's plain sailing for Pepper up top. Will Muir comes in working hard from his wing, but gets stopped 5 metres shy. Barbary leaves the ball behind, and Portugal have got a bit of room here, and they've got a few numbers as well. Scampering through tackles, and that's hard work from Lucy Tuwima, who's chased back to make that hit that needed to come. Portugal with a bit of wind in their sails from deep, though. Before they get a tear in their sail, Francisco Almeida driven back.
Step back. Use it, please.
Bit of air on the ball for Portugal.
Nine.
Love that, the look up just to see what's on before touch is found.
Another input. Balls in play.
But England, they want to play fast. They want to give these threatening backs a bit of transition ball. Portugal are down a man because Almeida is getting patched up, but the touchline will beat everybody.
Man down.
Stop for the injury now. That phase of play before, Russ Tuima, another really, really important act. Makes a great cover tackle. Great shot that on Barbary, whose cannonball is the appropriate term for him today. He is carrying hard. Let's have a look here. This is the counter-attack. It's really good. You're going to see it. This is Barbary's big carry. Here's the counter. Now, Russ Tuima here makes such an important cover tackle.
Seb?
Here he comes.
Yep.
Brilliant cover tackle from the big man. Working hard to get back.
You good, Tim? Sure. How's the halftime?
He's very different to a lot of the second rows out there in England at the moment, isn't he, Christian?
Yeah, he's that breed of second row that France have made popular, the tight head second row. He's as wide as he is tall, he's still pretty tall. He's just a big, big man.
Ball palmed back by Baptista, who, as you said, Christian, has been really prominent since being introduced for Antonio Andrade.
Hold up! Move!
Yeah, and I'll be clear on this. Carrying into the likes of Pepper, Pearson, Barbary is not an easy job. So he's done that with some zest, and he's had some good actions. England now, perfect place to launch, edge of the 22. Lots of space to exploit from the set piece. Let's see what they've got.
Jules, imperious in the East Midlands skies. Caden Murley, the latest to be hunting for work. Hunting for time on the ball. Joe Hayes goes bulldozing through a few tackles. Surely for England, surely for Guy Pepper, who gets swallowed up by the red jerseys. Desperate, heroic defence from the Portuguese.
And with the new law held up over the line, means the 22 dropout rewards that good defence. Some people think it should reward the other way, but that's what the rule is at the moment. Great carry from Big Joe Hayes, popular with the Tigers fans. And here he is, it just doesn't quite get there. Great work from the Portuguese tight head, Prim.
Yeah, feeds the insatiable Alfie Barbary, who just wants to run and run and run, and his carry's opened up a bit of room on the right edge. Again, Barbary sniffing for the ball, but Joe Hayes, he liked what he did last time and he wants a bit more. Dink over the top. Oh, that is exquisite from England. Telepathic between Atkinson and Ajomo. A try under the sticks and a hope of a half century and a half for England with the kick to come.
Very nice. Well, starts with the hard work of Barbary. You're right, he wants to carry that ball, doesn't he? To Atkinson, lovely, lovely execution. Ajomo, a man who can play 10 as well. Like you say, telepathic, they've been together a week. Such a hard skill to execute that. You know, the ball sat up nicely for Ajomo, but he started to finish it. But the skill just to lift it over that defensive line from Atkinson, really good. Referee there just saying there was no obstruction. Tries good. 50 points to the good for England at half time.
Josh Hodge with his easiest kick of the afternoon. Drills it home. And he drives England to that half century in a relentless opening 40 minutes. England A are back, and they are back with some bang in this first half. Half-time here at the Leicester Tigers Stadium. It is England A 50, Portugal 0. Well, a torrid old time for this young Portuguese side against turbocharged England, and well, take your pick of the highlights. There were plenty to choose from if you're of an English persuasion. And here strides the future of Portuguese. Great atmosphere throughout the match and great generosity to the fortunes of both sides, in all fairness. The Welford Road crowd just as delighted to see the fine play of Portugal as they have England, and England have delivered it in spades, Christian.
Yeah, first one of the day. It's the meat and drink for the England forwards. Good line-out drill. And that man, Jamie Plamaya, goes over, as you say, as he often does. This one, fantastic ball from Atkinson. It's that man, Pearson, on the outside. Charlie Atkinson, he hasn't had a good day off the tee, but from distribution-wise, he's been fantastic. Another try from the mall. The grounding, this one from Barbary. Might have had another look on another day, but we'll give the cannonball that one, particularly because of that haircut.
It's quite a mustachio lid combo that he's sporting there, Barbary. He has been everywhere, absolutely everywhere. And this guy's not been bad either.
Yeah, big rush to Ema. That's what we know he can do, those heavy traffic carries. But this from the big man, the dummy, pirouette, and the one-handed offload to Wilmer the horse. And we know he can gallop down the wing, as we see him do for Bath. And by this time, England were purring. And every time that England have put the tempo high, they've just been too hot.
Arcadia Merley wasn't going to let Wilmer have all the fun, and neither was Josh Hodge. This back three delivering on a lot of the excitement and promise ahead of the game.
And that was probably the pick of the tries for me, because of the set-piece execution, the set-play execution, and then just a bit of magic on the end from Hodge. He looks a classy player, as does Atkinson with that little piece of skill to close off the half.
England putting on a show out here, and the fans here in the East Midlands lapping it up. Well, England rugby have been busy. They've been bringing you games from across the country. Had a good old day down in Cornwall for the big one. Newquay against St Just, and Chris Ashton and Joe Launchbury heading down there. But also this week's This Rose episode gets to know Chandler Cunningham South and shows what the team got up to in their fallow week, including their open training session at Swickham.
How are you, bro? You good? Yeah, who you think you're waiting on? I take you to the early morn. Just when you're waking up, you feel like you're falling on. Above a cliff so high. So we've had a few days off after the Wales game, which has been nice to sort of chill out, rest a bit. Went back, saw the boys that I live with, which was nice, and managed to get my hair done as well, which
which I needed doing for a while. But yeah, it's been good and sort of regrouped yesterday, so Wednesday, and yeah, ready to get back into the week and hopefully attack Scotland next week.
I'm going to start with welcome backs. Mari Tulangi, Ollie Lawrence, and with a special hairdo, Mr. Luke Cowan-Dickie.
Yeah, it's been a crazy couple of weeks for me. Obviously, coming in to this Six Nations group has been really cool, and it's been a pretty unreal experience, to be fair. It's happened quite quickly, and I've learnt heaps from all the coaches and players and stuff, and yeah, just been happy to be here. My journey is probably a bit different to, you know, some of the other boys in camp and stuff, because obviously I was born here and then went over to New Zealand when I was 4 years old. So I did most of my schooling and, like, obviously my young rugby when I was over there. And then got the opportunity to come back when I was 18, and then sort of just grabbed it with both hands and came over here and got the opportunity with London Irish. And then the coaches there, like Fish and stuff, sort of just took me under their wing and always taught me everything about the professional rugby ways, and I learned a lot, to be fair, and I suppose it's changed how I am. And yeah, it's been good.
Ruiz with the initial choke. There it goes, there they score. Coming up south, listen to the roar.
Obviously it was a big change to come over here when I was 18, but it was just sort of an opportunity I couldn't really turn down. And I felt like I would develop quickly over here, and that's happened with a lot of help from guys like Fish, sort of pushing me in the right direction and guiding me and helping me to become a better rugby player and a better person as well.
And the final thing for me, boys, a hell of an occasion. You're lucky, say? Lucky. This is a privilege, boys. A special, special night for us. So go and get what you deserve, eh? Let's get what you deserve tonight, boys.
Chandler came onto my radar, as well as the under 20 selectors, from a guy called John Fisher, who was working at London Irish with Chandler. Yeah, he'd notified us around the fact that he'd started playing for Esher Rugby Club, and followed up with some highlights reels of his first game, which was pretty impressive.
I think coming over as an 18-year-old back to London, I was very, very raw player, very inexperienced player, and didn't really know much about the professional environment and sort of what it was, really. But I suppose I had to be confident, come over here and sort of just back myself to learn a lot and just soak it all up.
We're here in Newquay for a Cornwall Classic. Newquay Hornets take on St Just RFC as part of England's Play Together, Stay Together campaign to shine a light on grassroots rugby.
This is what grassroots rugby is all about.
Oh, they got through on that left flank.
Come on, boys!
Does this look big on me?
There's a little bit big. It's not right.
Guys, you've been mentoring the teams. How are we feeling about today?
I'm back in St Just today. I think they're going to do a job, yes.
We have a home advantage. Newquay win. Pretty impressed with the four pack last week.
Are you running water, Jeff?
Slowly. That's the one thing you'll beat me at today, I reckon.
Now it's time for every one of us, winners, fullbacks, to come looking for the work. Boys, it's those brilliant basics. Let's get them nailed off the
get-go. Lots of people are coming to watch, lots of people have heard about it, lots of people see it online. It's a really, really nice opportunity to create a legacy for us as a group of mates.
One, two, three, scream!
A big crowd here at the Newquay Sports Centre as the two teams come down the hill, ready for this one. Irresistible from the home side, and the first try is there.
Come on, boys!
Well, that was one from the training paddock on Thursday, no question about that.
Don't deprive me of my one job!
The referee has blown for half-time, so the home side with that seven-point advantage.
From the 22 to the 10, you're on a box, kick long.
We need someone to get us on the front foot, let's carry on.
One, two, three,
three!
Come on, boys!
Pasco veers round one and veers round another.
Oh, they got through on that left flank.
No!
That could be the critical score in this game.
Oh, he's dropped it.
There you go!
Here is a pickup and try!
Oh, hello.
Oi! That is one of yours. It's great to see you and Joe out with these guys.
It's just no frills rugby. Everyone's there for have a good time. Just meet up with mates. I have a feel-good factor. I really enjoy just getting out there again and just spending time with people that genuinely love rugby and just love being part of it.
Yes!
That's it. A big, big win for Newquay Hornets. Huge credit to both teams for playing in such awful conditions.
I think it's massive for everyone. I think the club, the players, obviously we knew coming up to today it's going to be a tough game, but the opportunity from England and play together, stay together, I think it's massive for everyone.
What a day, what an occasion, and I think we can all agree that rugby was the real winner. Oh, and Newquay Hornets. If you are looking to get back involved in grassroots rugby, then head over to findrugby.com.
England return, having plundered 50 points in the first half. And the sights of Greg Fisselout looks to have joined the ranks, another Exeter man. And judging by the haircuts out there, it's for Alfie Barbary.
Yeah, Greg Fisselout's not going to drop any kind of power in the carrying department, that's for sure. So it'd be good to see him get a run out. Plenty of other exciting names on this England bench that we want to see through this second half also.
Well, Portugal have been out for quite a while now, eager to get back into the action, and it's an important to sort of stress the enormity of this occasion. There are 16 debuts out there this evening today. The crowd here today in Welford Road, exceeding 15,000, is larger than the biggest ever home crowd in Portuguese rugby. So the occasion, the quality of opposition, this is all going in the experiential bank for this young Portuguese side with eyes on the World Cup in 4 years. And wow, that's a big hit coming in from João Cabasso, the replacement wearing 20. And on comes another replacement wearing 20, slaloming through the Portuguese defence. Fisselout takes England to the doorstep of the 22. Then a ball threaded through. Which England hands will reach it? Josh Hodge was the one who arrived on the scene first. But just too much altitude on the bounce and slipping through his grasp.
Yeah, it's nice play from England. Jomo, we said he's that second distributor that teams love to have. Not a bad first touch for Fisselout, makes a 30-metre clean break. And then this here, Jomo again, steps in at 10. Great pace from Beard and Hodgson there, but didn't quite get the nice bounce they needed to wrap up the perfect start to the half.
Ventura replacing Francisco Almeida, his namesake, but the change of personnel doesn't yield any different result in the scrum exchanges. And I tell you what, I think in England hadn't got that, but the whistle may have already gone, and Luke Ramos is heading to underneath the uprights. It's a penalty try. So 7 chalked up for England within minutes of the recommencement of the second half, and there's the power again.
I'm not going to take anything away from this England team. And Portugal get up with the game again.
Leon, fair contest in here.
Ball's back in play.
Well, Jay Hayes has been denied a try, which is quite a rare occurrence if you're Joe Hayes. I won't read out his try-scoring statistics per appearances for Leicester, but they may have been selling T-shirts after that one to say I was there. England still get the 7, though. Will Muir goes in pursuit. So good aerially. That 7's experience. 7th World Cup silver medalist in San Francisco, and he's down stricken at the moment. England, Bath, and the 2 cars of supporters from Gisborough will want to see him up and on his feet. That cross turn hasn't worked out, but how about that for connection? Murley to Hodge, seeking the offload. It sort of ricochets out of the hands, not forward called. And that was just beautiful, that sort of basketball airborne pass from Caden Murley.
Portugal looking to go cross-field, and Caden Murley's learnt. They quite like the look of that and plucked it out the air as a man as good as he is in the air does.
Time off. Red player down.
Got injuries, so we have a little break in play. And that man, Josh Hodge, again, getting on the ball. He's so dangerous, the way he kind of slaloms, he runs. Tried to get a little chicken wing offload on the outside. He got knocked down by a Portuguese player, but then kicked dead by England. And in that circumstance, it's a 22-metre dropout, and that's how we'll start this game. this injury goes all the way back to the contest in the air with Muir. I think it was off the first, first kickoff.
So
Portugal just raced back to the middle, tried to kick a contestable kick short. And that man, Will Muir, we said he's so good in the air. He contested hard, plucked it out of the air. I think they both came out of it a little bit worse for wear.
Keep going.
That contest on Muir, and it's he.
Wait, please.
Whose afternoon is ended, which is a real shame.
Remember? Okay. Who is the new captain?
But he's certainly done his reputation no harm in the 43 and a half minutes that he has spent on the field.
The referee's actually asking who the new captain is because he's mistaken Will Muir for Charlie Ewells. They do look alike in both facially and size-wise, so understandable mistake.
I was there when a bar supporter mistook him for Elliot Stook, in fact, once.
It's a lot worse.
Hold, four.
Big contestant, José María Cortés, is the one to spin away. Older brother Antonio has played internationally for Portugal. But today, José María getting his debut. Nice ball to Baptista, who again is offering some physicality in the midfield. Ollie Hartley, who's on for Will Muir, catches his opposite man, and the penalty, the reward for the tackle.
14 off your feet.
Good first action there for Hartley. Probably not what you want to start your game, an outside break against you, but he just reeled his man in. He's physically, he's a big guy, isn't he? He's bigger than I thought. I've not seen him play live before. Reeled in his man, got him to ground. Let his teammate go to work over the ball and win the turnover.
6'4" and 15 stone.
Big for an outside back. Good though from Beers. Beers coming to contest, and actually the penalty's given for sealing off there on the Portuguese side. It's the Portugal number 14, Vicar Gomes.
England into the corner, into the hands of the captain, and once again.
Down by White.
The gears grind into action, but it grinds to a halt on this occasion. Joe Hayes has been all action, very, very penetrative in his carrying, and Finn Baxter too, like a Scud missile, low into the shins of the Portuguese. Rusi Tuima reaching for another. They're getting all wrapped up.
Goal line.
Well, to give real credit to this Portuguese side, like, it's a physical mismatch today, it really is, the physical size. But there's no lack of desire, there's no lack of putting body on the line. And again, another held up from Russ Tuima here. He's a mad mountain of a carrier, but body on the line, underneath the ball, and holds it up really well. And earns their team a goal line dropout.
England's feeding Fisala, who's cut in half magnificently by Cavasso. Tuima, slightly different proposition. Hodge just coasting through the hole and losing his own footing. It was a wonderful outside to in, but England are pouring through the Red Sea. Atkinson receiving the offload, spinning, finding a Jomo, who fluffs his lines.
Knock on field.
Everybody was on their feet already.
Bissell's made some impact, hasn't he? That man Atkinson again, he's looked brilliant, ball in hand. Very, very generous. And that is as close as you get to an open net in rugby.
There may be some sort of fine attached to ball shelling behaviour like that from a man who's been outstanding otherwise, hasn't he?
He has been, and I'm sure his teammates are not going to let him forget about that one. The danger these days, isn't it? You become a highlight reel, you'll be on YouTube for the rest of your life. Great play up to that point. Great play from England, good ball handling. let down at
the
last. Portugal do incredibly well under immense duress. Nothing has been easy for the men in red today. They continue to play and they continue to find room between the arms of the England defenders. They battle to stay in field and then probe down the short side, but it's an alleyway that only has defenders in white, and England off in a hurry but called back.
It's a red ball.
Love the ambition from England.
Touched by white before out.
It's not their ball, unfortunately. It's coming back for a Portuguese lineout.
It's ripped by
the
white.
The ambition from Portugal is crazy. White. This crowd are being treated to 15,000 people here today. It's brilliant. But Portugal, behind their own line, still playing out, still stretching this England defence, who today defended very well.
Well, a bit of confusion as to who was due to take the next pass there, and standing work from Light. Great power from the outside centre.
Not far away.
And worthy of a penalty.
Yeah, Vasco Light at the outside centre. He's actually looked quite useful, hasn't he? He's quite pacey. Looks dangerous. Likes an outside break.
Yeah, he's had a bit of interest from French clubs, in fact, Vasco Light. And he fended off their attentions to stay in Portugal to pursue his studies. So prioritising education over the rugby dream for now. And it should be said that there's great representation from Bucks Super Rugby in England A ranks as well. Six of them having come through the university system. And that marriage of education and rugby, plain to see on both sides. Here he is. Oh, lovely, deft hands, instinctively knowing that Boaventura Almeida was there.
It's the man Pepper again, though. If he's not making a destructive tackle, he's slowing the ball down or he's turning it over. I tell you, the other man who's like that, the Curry twins, they're just always, always defensively involved. And Guy Pepper's got a talent for it.
Different sort of shape to the boy, though, isn't he? You know, a bit more lither seems to be a step quicker. I know the Currys are quick, but there seems to be a little bit more zip about Pepper, maybe.
I think I grade people either quicker or slower than me, and they're all quicker than me, so yeah, he looks like an athlete, doesn't he? I've got to say, when I've heard people speak about him in his training, he's just very, very impressive. He's been spoken about for a while.
Well, Jules has ruled the East Midland skies, and he commands the rest of his pack to propel themselves forward again. Portugal have defended that resolutely.
We've praised him a lot since he's come on, but Baptista here, how he gets away with this, I have got no idea.
One, two, three and four, he
very much sacks that ball and earns the turnover. The referee would be very generous. But there's some heavy-duty goods coming on the pitch for England in the front row, which is probably the last thing Portugal need at this stage.
Wow. Love the road, Bryce, their feet, not just because their man Joe Hayes is departing, but Finn Baxter, Jamie Blomar and Lucy Tuima, we've all had star turns, and heralding the arrival of Sam Riley, Tarek Kafar, Josh Yosefa Scott and Big Ben Bamba, and I mean Big, the sound man, a giant at 6'9" and 126 kilos, so...
And he can shift. He's not a heavy 126 kilos. He can move with it as well.
Sit.
But maybe a little too much exuberance from the new front row and engine room there.
At the mark.
Yeah, I mean, I hate to say it, they've brought a Premiership engage there to a game that isn't probably at that Premiership physicality. And they'll adjust. They need to adjust quickly. Probably a bit too much adrenaline coming off the bench, but I'm sure they will adjust. And these boys who've come on are no smaller than the boys who've just gone off.
Yes, you've thrown the 134 kilos of Josh Yosefa Scott, and there's a bit of ballast, let's say, that's just been introduced from the bench. First inaccuracy, really, from the Portuguese line-out, and Sam Riley gobbles up the crumbs. It's the shade of inaccuracy from England, but Ollie Hartley finds a way to maximise it, and Riley, who was scooping up the crumbs, is now rampaging down the right.
Play on.
Wow, the Portuguese were right in their instincts, and then they hesitated. Then Guy Pepper takes England to the fight. Pearson, the chicken wing out. Riley looking to make it to the line. It's tight. And it's there. On for a minute. And a try already for the Queen's hooker.
Turnover ball on the line out from Portugal. You said they've been quite slick this afternoon, but then England work it close to the line. That man Pearson, good line, good offload. See if he gets it down. Definitely think he does. This angle will show us. Lovely from Pearson. He's been strong today, hasn't he? Good carry from Riley. Yeah, he gets that down. Infield. Good finish.
He is in some battle for the two jersey at Queen's. You've got Jack Walker, Nathan Jabulu, Jack Musk. And that competition is serving to carry him to higher heights. Try an England A debut. And the man who used to shoot competitively for GB, for once, doesn't hit a bullseye from the tee here at Welford Road. Tom Pearson's been in everything, hasn't he?
Right again?
He has, and he's that big rangy athlete, isn't he, where he can reach through tackles. He hits intelligent lines, but he's physical as well. It's such a difficult thing to match up to as a defender.
Hodge takes the kickoff, looks utterly serene in everything that he does.
He's probably been the pick of the back so far, doesn't he? He just looks very calm and composed whilst he just glides past the defending.
Back.
Something I wish I could do.
Guess who? Tom Pearson collecting the high ball from Harry Randall that might not have gone quite as far as he would have wished.
Use it nine.
Well, a bit of additional scaffolding added to the ruck. The drop of the shoulder to unsettle the Portuguese charges. That is a magnificent take with a lot of white jersey in Alfredo Almeida's headlights. He's been very good, the fullback. And Cardoso is battling away amongst the big boys. Ben Bamba is one of them in, and Portugal go riding through that melee of white jerseys. The captain tips on to José Roch. Nice passage for Portugal. Oh. Uncompromising stuff on Almeida.
Lost. Tackle underway.
And just a nibble. Did that get knocked on? Cabasso won't ask the referee to blow. And Cardoso goes to his eight. Then out the back, looking to get beyond the blitz. Nice speed from Nobre. But England hunting in a pack, hunting for wolves. Great penetration on some of these carries now from Portugal. It's something they've been missing. The inside ball collected by Pepper, who's freed up the left arm for an offload and then has a chuck goal and eventually
up on there, back to
loses it.
Time off. One, two, and three, red.
That man there, Pepper, he's...
9 and 10
he's impressive,
again.
Very impressive. I tell you, that man Fizzolau as well has come on. He makes loads and loads of positive contributions, very noticeable. He doesn't just make a tackle and stick, he's on his feet, he counter-rucks. When he ball carries, he's looking to pass, he's looking to beat people. He's been impressive since he's come on.
Wholesale front row change for Portugal with the Cunha, Rodriguez and Turabalidze on. The departure of Harry Randall and Charlie Atkinson, who's pulled the strings with aplomb today. As he makes way, on comes Jamie Shilcott. to play fly half. And Caelan Englefield, former Ireland under 18, now firmly of the Red Rose.
Yeah, I think 9 and 10 for England have been good today, actually. You know, Atkins has struggled off the tee, but he's controlled the game well. And Harry Randall's been Harry Randall. Box of tricks. Brilliant when he plays quick.
Vantage.
Englefield skirts off and calls for it from Fisalau, and then England wend their way back to the left. Hodge hit low and shows remarkable strength for such a wiry athlete. Tariq Hafar, who is all explosivity, booms through a couple of tackles. Shilcott to Ajomo. Doesn't give it to Bamba, instead gives it to Murley, who weaves inside and might have just found himself isolated. England just about resourced the ruck in time. Pearson, some heavy lifting in the middle. Hafar wants an Irishman, now a Saint. Beard out the back to Shilcott, looking to get that final pass away. Shilcott, miraculous. An escapologist and reaching and somehow finding the line. Well, it seemed he was tackled once, twice, thrice. But Jamie Shilcott with the desire to hit the paint and register another try for England.
We'll have to see how he gets there on this one. We can't quite work it out. He beats a man there. And another twist and reaches out that left hand. Plops the ball down just fine. It looked like he was tackled at least once, twice, didn't it? And shows really good body strength. Here, I thought they had him. Just shakes them both off. You see the left hand come out. There it is. Two hands.
Seems harsh on Josh Hodge to relieve him of the tee after just one miss, but Jamie Shilcott has a pretty sweet left boot of his own.
I did see Josh Hodge come kind of trotting over, and he just, yeah, I've got it. I think if you're a fly half with a decent boot, there's a certain amount of control on that tee, isn't there? You don't give it up easily.
Well, that is a very contestable kickoff and brilliantly taken. I think it was Oscar Beard there, who's been solid in everything that he's offered. Quite excitement around the young Quinn. And England go to the skies. Oh, that is majestic. Oh, it is extraordinary. It is the loudest roar of the day. The Manuel Varela, who owned the atmosphere of the East Midlands, and then dovetailed it with electric feet and an injection of pace to get the Leicester Tigers Stadium on its feet.
Brilliant. Properly brilliant. What a take. He's the man, and he shows real pace here. Real pace. And he's celebrating short of the line as well. And the crowd made a great noise for him as well. Brilliant. What a take.
A moment to truly savour for the 19-year-old, and look at that. His teammates piling in for a magic moment for Rosh Lobosh.
And his bench has done him an absolute injustice here. He's only got 30 seconds on the shot clock. They forgot to bring the tee on.
20.
Unable to maximise his moment. But listen to the applause. Really, what a saver for Manuel Valero and his Portugal side.
Ah, there's a little moment of joy there, isn't there? Really is. They've stuck at it, Portugal. Still 20 minutes to go. Still playing rugby.
Yeah, Barreiro, he's one of the most promising products from the 20s programme, which Gonçalo Faro coaches. He's been the starting 10 for the Portuguese champion since he was 18 years old, so a wise head on young shoulders, but that time seeing all the youthful athleticism and adventure that you want from a man emerging on the international scene.
Step back.
Pearson with the charge down. Of course it's Pearson. Englefield to Bamba. Lovely sleight of hand. And Jomo sizes up the crossfield momentarily, then says, no, I'll dance through the defence instead. Chilcock, this time he is denied. Fissalan to Hafar. Solid hit coming in low on the replacement. Prop out of a blind spot and into Tritown for Oscar Beard. He came from nowhere.
Great finishes from Beard. Does the old 2 foot stutter step and just leaves the guy. Great charge down from Pearson. Said he's been involved in so much today. Let's have a little look at it here. Comes off the nine shoulder, lovely. Two footed stutter step, just so difficult. A man that so quick. There was a really nice bit in the build up actually, where Jomo got the ball. He was going kind of crossfield, and then he spotted the tight end prop on the outside, and all of a sudden he was like, actually, we'll take you on, and that kept the play going. It got to Chilcock on the outside, and then they scored. It's great to see a Jomo with his heads up like that, you know, identifying that weak link and taking it on. It's what you need your outside backs to do.
Well, there's one way to do it. Jamie Chilcock adds the extras, and that man said quite openly at the start of the season that his ambition is to play for England, and he's done those ambitions no harm today, has he?
Yeah, it's always horrifying when a man that quick with that two-footed step, you don't know which way he's going.
Time off, please.
Off the right that time, to the left of the defender, and a well-deserved score. He's been good, Beard, hasn't he? Just quietly understated, not quite as showy as Hodge maybe has been in the back line, but he's been one of England's best performers for sure.
Time back on.
Yes, he's knitted things together rather nicely, the outside centre. We haven't said Pearson's name for a while, so he gathers the kickoff. Josefa Scott is ignored. And Ollie Hartley, sort of old-fashioned dummy, opens up the short side of the pitch. Guy Pepper pistons his way across the halfway line, and Josefa Scott on this occasion gives it to Chilcock. Hafar, great offload out of the tackle, and Ajomo sizing up the options. He says, I'm going to go it alone. Dribbles one through to Chase, and that's an extraordinary take under immense pressure there. The penalty conceded, though. All the traffic travelling left to right now in this half.
Good take from the kickoff from Pearson. Ajomo, he's good at spotting the space, not afraid to put it on his foot. We've seen the chip where he scored off, obviously. Good chase here for the penalty. I think it's for sealing off, I'm not quite certain.
Ajomo's another one of these young men who already amassed a load of caps for their clubs. He's got over 50 at the age of 23 for Bath. And Sam Riley's another one as well. He goes to Charlie Yules, who's been around the senior camp. He was playing in the last England A game back in 2016 in South Africa. It was a tour. It was an undefeated one for England A, and the rebirth will start in similar fashion.
Leave it.
But you have to applaud the Portuguese for their more defence. It hasn't been all England's way, has it? Particularly in the second half.
It hasn't. And this is the kind of thing that will frustrate the England coach. And Josh Givington's having a look, shaking his head at something. This is the kind of thing where, with the ball being thrown onto Charlie Yule so cleanly there, they should have a really good set. They should have a real tight around the ball. One of the Portuguese players managed to get through and onto it, and just spoiled the party a little bit for England.
Let's go, guys. Quick reset. Mark is here.
Charlie Hughes, in the press conference before this match, was rather unfairly referred to with regularity as the dad of the group.
I did want to raise this. Like, he's been around forever, Charlie Hughes. He really has. He's 28 years old. Like, he's entering his physical prime as a second row. Definitely still do a job as that kind of intelligent steerer of the ship that you need often in a team that functions, and you need different balance. We said it with the England back row today. You know, Pearson, Pepper, Bardry, brilliant balance to it. In the second row, sometimes you need a Russ Touima who's going to smash the door down, but you need a Charlie Yules who's going to win your lineouts, all your kickoffs, and steer everyone in the right direction. That's what he brings to the party. He's a good player. I know Bath were keen to keep hold of him this year, despite interest from abroad, from other teams. And I'm glad to see Charlie stay. He's a good leader, good player.
Crowds! Bye!
Another scrum penalty for England. It's been hard yakka for the Portuguese eight out there today.
On the line.
An attack move with Fisalau and Yules. Not receiving it. That looks really awkward and uncomfortable. Fisalau fizzing for England and firing himself across the line. Another try for England, another scorer, Greg Fisalau, the Plymouth-born powerhouse, making his mark on this afternoon's match.
I like the look of Fisalau. I like watching Greg's as well. What I love is that he doesn't just do one thing. I mentioned it earlier. He has multiple actions. He's always hungry for work. The power of his carrying is undisputed. I am interested to see where he ends up. He can play eight, he can play seven. Be good for him, I think, to understand where he's going to be long-term. But he's a player who's just hungry to be involved, just like Barbary was in the first half. Good carry here, he's just too powerful. Great latch on the outside. Who was that? Charlie Yules said, sometimes you need a man who does the boring stuff. Makes the make the Greg Fisalau's of this world look good.
Portugal, their verve for counter-attack rugby undiminished though. Although there aren't many avenues to run down. It's been a very connected England defence this afternoon. But Portugal, unrelenting. José Rock has got through a mountain of work.
Selling
number eight, but his penalties really hamstringing Portugal as well.
And it's the pressure that England are bringing at the breakdown, and I'm going to say it because it was the person I was just talking about. Greg Fisalau was the first man on the chase. He made the next tackle, and then he forced the turnover there because he went into contest, and the Portuguese player had to seal it off. He's a hungry young man, and that's what we need in these England shirts, isn't it? People hungry to wear the shirt. And since he's come on at half-time, he's been very aggressive in a very impressive display by this England 18.
Say again, please.
Nine red. Acknowledgement of everyone, all 15,153. We've come today, and Duarte Cortes.
Thank you. Point back on.
Comes on.
Comes in, please.
Duarte Cardoso's replacement at scrum half. And he's tight to his try line straight away. Guy over 15. Extends those Rick fingers away. And
thank you.
Fisalau snaffles suboptimal ball. He may well have just been ensnared. They're called.
7.
Messi from England.
7, side entry.
Yeah, and a little bit of this comes from, you know, short period of time together, substitutes coming on, the drill at the line-out wasn't quite clean enough as the way it should be. Leads to a poor lift, lose the ball, and it's chaos. We said this Portuguese team, if you let them play chaos, they're pretty good at it. And defensively, they continue to try and man up against a much more physically big team.
There's been a great emphasis this week with England, who've been living and training at Loughborough University, to just get to know each other, to acknowledge that because they're sat in the room, they are good players, and that there's been a lot of trust put into their ability to read the game, to play the game as they see it, and no one has seen it quite like Josh Hodge, who sighted through the Portuguese defence. 3 metres shy, England looking for the try-scoring pass, and the try machine, Caden Murley. He bags his second of the day. With the Portuguese defence scrambling, it was meat and drink for a man as potent as Caden Murley. And England across the whitewash once again.
Josh Hodge again, just gliding. Glides at 100 miles an hour. Murley's been hungry, hasn't he, today? He's been hungry for the ball. Hasn't always come to him, hasn't always had the breaks. But he's hungry, he's a finisher. I said he changes his pace so well. He's deceptively powerful. That makes it so hard to defend. You know, somebody who performs at the same pace non-stop, it's predictable, whereas Murley just seems to have that ability, change pace, change angle, bump you off in the tackle, and he finishes off tries.
No extras for Jamie Shilcott. Caden Murley, the only try scorer to help himself to 2 today. Otherwise, it's been shared around the England ranks. And when the captain's run yesterday, I'd say he clean bowled Alfie Barbary. Well, he's castled Portugal today with a brace as well. Josh Hodge continues to grow, and Murley lurking with intent on the shoulder.
We did say, didn't we, we're going to be hyper critical. Those kind of offloads, we want to see them sticking. We want to see players
up and wide.
We want to see players going the distance.
And Christian, we're getting to that stage where it's time to award the player of the match, the individual who stood out the most in a game of many, many big performances.
Yeah, it's the Champagne Bollinger player of the match, no less. I've got to say, there's been great performances across the board. We mentioned Hodge lots. I said that I think 9 and 10 for England went really well, Randall and Atkinson, but that man, Tom Pearson, he's just had so many involvements today where he's dictated this game, whether it be catching kickoffs, making big hits, big ball carries or scoring tries. So the Bollinger player of the match is Tom Pearson.
First man, good turnover.
And characteristically, he's into the fray and into half-back. Bit of a streaky ball that does work out for his backline division. This is another man who's shone in the centre. Just look uber-composed.
On the ball.
Muscular stuff from the Portuguese in defence.
Thank you.
Who continue to empty their defensive tanks. Josh Hodge looking increasingly slippery. Every time he receives possession, Youssefa Scott, more of a battering ram, and there's the player of the match. There's the chicken wing, and now it's Sam Riley careering in open green pastures at the Leicester Tigers Stadium. Englefield to Pearson, who dismisses the challenge of Jason Rodriguez. Yules out the back, Shilcott spots some room, Murley in for a hat-trick! the cherry on top.
And Caden Burley gets another to the tally, but it came from so much good rugby before it. Pearson, clean break. Chicken Wing Offlow, Riley, he's in deep water. He's a little step on the wing, but not quite the gas to get there. And this from Shilcott's really nice. Really nice. Half break. Throws a 20-metre ball over the top to Murley. Like I said, he'll finish the more difficult tries. It's still got to be finished. Takes the ball clean, dots it down in the corner for a hat-trick. At the Leicester Tigers Stadium.
Well, many have been clamouring for that man to get a full England cap. He was the Premiership's top try scorer last season with 15 in 18. He's certainly not made the conversion attempts easy for Jamie Shilcott since he's been handed the tee. He isn't quite able to curl that one in. A raise of the eyebrows and a shrug of the shoulders, but he was the creator for Caden.
Yeah, he's slippery, isn't he, Murley? We said Steve Borthwick watches on. Not sure how much he'll have learned today watching this, but he certainly sees there's people hungry for the shirt.
And for Portugal, this has been a tough lesson, but they do have a big fixture next week. The Iberian Derby in the semi-finals of the Rugby Europe Championship, the tier below the Six Nations, and all of this will go into that experiential bank for these young men. It will paint the picture of the future of a nation who is so eager to grow its presence on the international stage beyond the waters they usually fish in.
Over 15.
A slick line out in the 77th minute.
Move away.
No lack of ambition and bravery from this Portugal side, I say that.
Just a slight lack of connection that works out well for Vasco Light, who was certainly stood out in the centres. Josh Hodge continues to stand out and he picks out some room and then delivers a punishing chase and tackle. Portugal back in their half with Kevin Baptista. Smart hands, inside ball and the door slammed shut and stolen in the process as well. Bamba did so well. Bit of zip from the try scorer Vereiro. And a bit of dogged fight across the 10-metre line. Rock, another carry. Him and Baptista. Not sure there's enough Epsom salts in Leicester for their bodies after the work rate from those two today. And Vereiro brings Luke Ramos into a clinch that I'm not sure he wanted to be a part of.
Yeah, the second biggest cheer of the day, that one, I think, after the try from Vereiro. Tom Pearce has just been announced as player of the match. I think lots of applause. It could have been any number of players, I'll be honest. There's been really good performances across the board in this England A team, but I've got to say, I think Pearson just stood out, just his involvement, just like Fislau in the second half. He's never far from the ball. He always seems to be doing something, involved with something, affecting the game.
Crouch, bind, set.
The clock begins to tick to 80 and Rock picks and goes and Portugal weave back to Almeida. He's offered himself as a second receiver and gets Greco-Roman to the floor by Guy Pepper.
Thank you.
Bit of invention and Beard scrambling and doing magnificently. And had quite a lot on his plate, so
knock on the ground.
Question marks as to whether he called the mark or not. And that will be the final act of a game that England have dominated from start to finish. Leicester Tigers Stadium has been treated to a tri-fest, England A style. There was one glimmering light for Portugal. It was the Manuel Guerreiro score that was just as generously roared across by the 15,000 plus who've come to watch the next generation of England stars today. Steve Borthwick, George Skivington will be very happy. He'll be delighted with a hat-trick. And England A are back, and they are back with a bang. Full-time here at the Leicester Tigers Stadium. England 91, Portugal 5. Thank you.
I said across the board today there have been really good performances. That man Pepo is impressive in the back row. I said defensively he's just a handful, someone you don't want to play against, and he was difficult in both the tackle and the contest. In terms of Portugal, you know, there was one or two stood out. Vasco Leita, Guerreiro the 10 who got the try, brought some real joy to the stadium, and Baptiste who came on and worked so hard in ball carrying. No lack of desire from Portugal or bravery to take the ball on, often from behind their own line or in their own half. But ultimately, England A just too strong, too physical, too big, but also performed very, very well on the day.
What does George Skivington, what does Steve Borthwick take from this and the performances out there today?
I said pre-game that, you know, all a player wants is an opportunity. They want a chance to prove themselves, and this was an opportunity today. For those players who Steve Borthwick has said that he expects to see them in a senior England shirt at some point in the future, it gave them a chance to put a marker down. So, and there were loads of players all through the pitch, one of which undoubtedly was England number six, Tom Pearson, who was our Champagne Bollinger player of the match, and I think we're going to hear from him soon.
Tom Pearson, congratulations, you are Champagne Bollinger player of the match. It was a really big win for England. How was the game out there?
Yeah, no, really good. Played a lot of attacking rugby. Kept hold of the ball pretty well, considering we've only been together for a week or so. Scoreline doesn't lie, so I'm happy.
A couple of tries for you today. Just nice finishes, finish off team moves?
Just a couple. Off the back of various things, but I think Caden probably feeling a bit robbed with his hat-trick, not being here, but there we go.
How's the week been just in general? Obviously, you mentioned it there. Lots of players getting together, coaching staff coming together. A really different week to anything, I guess, club or country before. What's it been like?
Yeah, no, really nice. Good to meet a few guys I've never met before, and like even better to play with them, to be honest. There's some serious talent out there. Like some of the guys, like 2021, running the show in like pivotal positions. So, you know, to play alongside those guys, yeah, it's been awesome.
Obviously, you've been around the England setup as well. Just getting out there, rose on your shirt, representing England. It must be a dream this week.
Yeah, it's brilliant. Really good. Like, I think it gives me and a load of guys like game time combinations, you know, that could fruition in the future. And, you know, it's been brilliant. I think the coaches have given us a lot of leeway to kind of do our own thing and just let us play, to be honest, and give us that freedom, which has been great this week. So, we appreciate that.
Tom Malego, celebrate. Congratulations.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
So, Portugal managers couldn't
get straight in. Just take a step that way.
Well, the dying embers of, you know, a wonderful afternoon for a lot of young England players looking to make their names, and I stress young, achingly young, some of these prospects, and a great camaraderie, as you can see there, that's been garnered over just one short week. Imagine if this group could take even more time together. Right, we've heard from the Champagne Bollinger player of the match. Now it's time to hear from Gonçalo Faro, the Portugal coach.
Gonzalo, obviously a difficult afternoon for your side. What did you make of your team's performance?
Well, it was a tough game for us. We already knew the difference between the two teams was big. Like you guys, we are. This is a development team, but the gap is really big now. We need these games for the gap to be shorter. Congratulations to England. Very good team, and hope we see you next time.
Okay. In terms of the performance of your side, though, they kept on going defensively, put a lot of effort in. How pleased are you with what your team did today?
Well, the effort was there. We tried to attack. England put a lot of pressure on us, pressure that we are not used to. Most of these guys play in our main championship, not professionals, most of them. So, but like I said, we need these games to improve.
Okay. How pleased in terms of the effort you put in? You got that try this afternoon and a really nice reaction from the crowd.
One of the things you said at halftime was we need to score a try. It was a bit lucky, but we were there and we got the try. We're happy.
In terms of just the overall day as well, the experience of your players, you mentioned a lot of young players at this level. This will help Portugal rugby so much.
Yeah, it helps a lot. Like, for example, the guy who scored the try has 18 years old. Most of the back line are 18, 19 years old, so they have a big way to go still, so let's keep working.
Gonzalo, thank you for your time and looking today. Welcome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Other side?
England coach.
George Skivington, congratulations, a big win for your team today. What did you make of the performance?
Yeah, look, I mean, obviously there was a void in probably the opposition and the quality of the boys, but we at half-time sort of sat down, be realistic about what the game, but can we keep working hard? Can we show real character? You know, and I think ultimately to score that many points is a challenge no matter who you're playing. And, you know, I'll give credit to Portugal. They stayed in there, they kept working hard, but I thought the character, the work rate, you've got to keep working, and sometimes the challenge becomes different as a game unfolds, and it's easy to, you know, maybe take your foot off the gas and think it's going to happen. And the boys didn't do that, so I'm really, really pleased with that, and I think they can pat themselves on the back.
There's a lot of exciting rugby out there. I know you spoke pre-match about it not turning into a sevens game, but in terms of what the players did from what you wanted from a coaching point of view, how pleased with the actual performance?
Yeah, I think they were pretty well connected. We knew Portugal would challenge the D with, you know, some helter-skelter stuff, and they found a couple of holes a few times, but for the most part, considering, you know, all Premiership teams defend differently, you've got to come together, attack differently, you know, set their mauls and scrums up differently. I thought the boys did a really good job of getting aligned, and if there were any creaks, they solved them pretty quickly. So, you know, they were good, and I thought Charlie Yules led that really well. I've got to say, his messaging to the boys in the game at half-time is outstanding.
In terms of the actual, I guess, focus as well from your team to be able to keep piling on those points, because it was a big lead at half-time, but they kept on going through the phases.
Yeah, and that was a message at half-time. Again, you know, how relentless can you be? And as I say, how hard can you keep working when it's actually all going your way? It's very easy to work hard when your back's against the wall in a Premiership match or, you know, first-team international game or whatnot. But actually, it's going your way. You're scoring tries. Can you keep going with that, and can you keep your pedal to the floor? Which they did.
I know we're only a couple of minutes post full-time, but just your reflection, I guess, on the week. A lot of young players playing an international rugby today, getting the players together, getting the coaches together. What's it been like?
Yeah, well, like I said before, it's been a great week, and, you know, we wanted to deliver something on the field, which they did, but, you know, it's such a special week to bring it back after 8 years of not having it, to get a group together, to see how quickly we can gel as a unit, not just in terms of rugby, but off the field. I've really enjoyed it. I think all the staff have really enjoyed it, and hopefully the players as well. And, you know, I think it's really positive. Over 15,000 people turn up to watch, and, you know, it's great for the England A games to be back.
In terms of the actual development as well for this, obviously Steve Borthwick's kind of been involved with his men's senior commitments. This is just another step, isn't it, for a group of players, hopefully, that he can look to select from in the future?
Yeah, absolutely, and credit to Steve. He's here today. He drove straight down after the game, and, you know, he's seen firsthand. He saw the boys around the hotel and seen them play, and as I say, we got as aligned as we possibly could with the first team, so he'll have seen the guys in his structure, and hopefully some guys have, you know, really put their hand up, and as I say, I know Steve will have been watching the work rate once things were going our way, and I think he'll be pleased with that.
George, congratulations today. Thank you for your time.
Cheers.
Thank you, George.
Well, plenty of bright moments to choose from in an England jersey. It wasn't to be for Joe Hayes there.
No, that was Joe Hayes' try. Joe Hayes' try, 100%.
He'll claim it, But unfortunately, the record books will say penalty try. But it was illustrative of the sheer power mismatch of England today.
Yeah, the scrum was a mismatch. It's such an important part of the game, and we often have a whinge, don't we, about the scrum. It takes time. It's so important. You saw that today. That was Pearson with an offload for Riley to score. This was Shilcock just saying, no, you ain't going to tackle me. Shedding off 3-4 tacklers to get to the line. And this was probably the biggest joy of the game, wasn't it? I mean, it was 80-odd points at this point of the game, but pure joy in this.
Caught at full canter. And even time for the fist pump celeb on the way. And I mean, everybody loved it here.
And England carried on playing. They carried on playing well. This was nice from Beard, that two-footed stutter step that just horrifies a lead-footed defender like me. And England kept cracking. Fisselau here, great latch from Charlie Yules. Fisselau was impressive when he came on. He was all action. He was all involvements. He'll have shown Steve Borthwick what he can do. And coming towards the end of things, this was Hodgson again, just glides at 100 miles an hour. I said he looked so calm, yet moves so quick. And eventually, England score in the corner.
Well, Caden Murley worked hard to get off his wing, and he wasn't given a hatful of opportunities, but he was to leave with a hat trick.
Yeah, beautiful ball out from Shilcock. He knows obviously Leicester Tigers Stadium well, but great ball off his left hand there. 15, 20 metre seed. Gives Murley his hat trick in the corner.
So wonderful moments have been seen between both sets of players. Charlie Yules having exchanged jerseys with Kevin Baptista, who is soaking up the adulation of the crowd here, and our champagne Bollinger player of the match, Tom Pearson, as well. Christian, your final reflections on the day?
Well, we said England A is here to stay. We think it's a great thing to bring it back. Seen some brilliant action today, and even though the scoreline shows the gulf, still an enjoyable watch, and really enjoyed being here.
England A, lain dormant for nigh on 8 years, has been awoken and erupted into life at the Leicester Tigers Stadium. They're back, they've returned with 13 tries and a handsome victory over Portugal. Final score after a wonderful afternoon here in front of over 15,000 at the Leicester Tigers Stadium. England A 91, Portugal 5.